In the North Carolina Museum of History's conservation labs, and in museums around the world, the debate is constantly waged. How to prevent pieces of history from becoming, well, history.
Okay, so we do as little to no harm as possible. You know, our goal is, you know, to stabilize the object while respecting its inherent beauty or its inherent value.
Call it the conservator's constant question. From this World War II Spitfire pilot's helmet, to a mold-covered photo of the North Carolina Supreme Court, to even the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, which was exhibited in Raleigh this summer. What is the best method to preserve an object without altering it?
All of the wires that are on the helmet and on the mask are covered in textile, and some of the textile is actually fraying. So what I'm doing is laying them down with an adhesive called Clusel G, and it is a hydroxypropyl cellulose that is used in textile conservation.
We don't restore, we don't bring things back, we don't bring objects back to what it was, what they used to look like. Because each object, it has a history. It has a group of people who have used it, who have touched it, who have, you know, altered it, if at all possible. Unless it is damaging the object, we try not to reverse that, if possible. Because that tells the story of an object. That tells the history, what it does, what it was used for, how it was treated.
Jennifer French has an impressive array of tools to preserve history at her fingertips. Yes, some of those are dental instruments. There are also chemicals, such as solvents and epoxies, glass microballoons to fill cracks and holes, Fuller's earth for removing dirt. There's also a library of research books to consult.
With conservation, what we do is we attempt to use materials that will slow down or reduce the rate of deterioration, but we can't completely stop it.
You'll see what we call first year of freedom.
That debate is even more intense when dealing with items of not only historic significance, but national importance. Take this for example. Before there was the Emancipation Proclamation, President Lincoln issued the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation.
Oh, it changed the course of the war, because what it does is it changed the official platform of the war from saving the Union only to include freeing 4 million enslaved African Americans. And in our state, 335,000.
This is the engrossed copy of the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, which means that the hand is in clerk's hand. And as part of that process, the two pages are put together and bound with ribbon, with a silk ribbon. The ends of the ribbon come out on the signature page.
But don't forget, it was a working document when it was issued September 22, 1862. So the paper was handled a lot back then. Conservators handle it as little as possible now.
Very limited use and limited exhibition time, so very hardly any light. It's in a vault, limited access. The damage is really physical damage from handling. And it's around those, the holes or the perforations in the paper that are fighting against the ribbon. And so really just in there with just very gentle reinforcing.
Remember that concept, gentle reinforcing. It's the watchword for the 150,000 objects in the collection of the Museum of History. Science provides multiple methods to preserve the items and tell their story.
Again, our mission is to educate our public on the, not only the great history of our state, but the history in general. You know, the fact that the things we do today will affect the things we do tomorrow, and the things that were done 100 years ago affect the things that happen today.
But sometimes the practical questions overshadow the science. When is an item so damaged it just can't be preserved?
And we have to think about, if you're going to give me something, what condition is it in when you give it to me? Because if it requires a lot of conservation, I may not have the funds or the staff to spend the amount of time to conserve that. So we have actually passed on artifacts that we'd like to have in the collection, but they were in such bad shape, we'd never be able to put them on display.
There's enough damage, there's enough deterioration of this particular object that warranted a complete removal of the seat cover.
Take this chair made by Thomas Day. Day was a free man of color, making furniture in Milton, in the antebellum South of the 1840s. The chair is a significant artifact that was heavily damaged by years of use and by multiple seat recoverings. The countless holes along the seat tell that story.
Right. We don't want to create new holes. If I can, and there are plenty of holes to choose from in this chair, if I can, I will probably reuse these holes. I need to find the right material that will strengthen the wood without damaging it further.
It will take many hours, but it turns out the chair can be preserved. The original horsehair that Day used in the 1840s has even been saved and will be used again in the cushion.
You get into this profession because you enjoy history. You enjoy, you know, interacting with these objects. And, you know, to be able to touch this and know that maybe not a famous person, but someone in the past touched it and used it and loved it or hated, you know, it's very interesting.